जस्ट वेरी अप्रिशिएटिंग कि पहली बार एहसास हुआ है कि पास हिंदी में अच्छा लग सकता है. अभी तक पास को पंजाबी में सुना था, पंजाबी में पढ़ा था, लेकिन नाइट सो नाइस के पास को पहली बार हिंदी में सुना. सो नाइस लिसन टू दैट. इस सेशन में हमारे पास पांच स्पीकर्स हैं. मैं उनको सबसे पहले इनवाइट करता हूं स्टेज पर. श्री अनूप सुरेंद्रनाथ जी, श्री जहीरुद्दीन अली खान, प्रोफेसर नंदिनी सुंदर जी, श्री के त्यागराजन और श्री ए टी सुरेश. I invite every speaker, all the speakers to please come on the podium. One thing that we have got at our disposal around 1 hour 30 minutes. That means 15 minutes for each speaker, and the rest of 15 minutes we can have for discussion also. So I request all the speakers to be that much brief so that they can finish their talk within 15 minutes, please. तो सबसे पहले मैं इनवाइट करूंगा श्री अनूप सुरेंद्रनाथ जी को, हु इज करेंटली द डायरेक्टर डेथ पेनल्टी रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट नेशनल लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी. अनूप जी एक एक्टिव कैंपेनर है अगेंस्ट डेथ पेनल्टी, और करेंटली वो इज एंगेज इन कंडक्टिंग सर्वेस ऑफ ओवर 450 डेथ रो प्रिजनर्स lodged in various states in India, and he is more concerned to speak against death penalty for structural reasons. So invite Shri Anup Surendernath to please come and deliver this talk. Anup ji.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll just briefly introduce the project before I get down to the substantive part of what I have to say. The Death Penalty Research Project at National Law University, Delhi, was we sort of started it mainly to address the concerns that you was raising in the session before lunch about the absolute lack of empirical research on the death penalty. The Death Penalty Research Project aims to interview all of India's death row prisoners. Nearly about 470 of them across all the jails in India where they are lodged. We also interview their families and their trial court lawyers. The project is being conducted in collaboration with the National Legal Services Authority, and the collaboration was authorized by Justice Sadasivam, as he then was, in his capacity as the chairperson of NALSA. As far as the funding of the project is concerned, it's completely funded by the university, and we've been very sure not to take foreign funding on this. Now, the project started in July 2013, and as of now, we've interviewed a little over 250 death row prisoners across the country, their families, and their lawyers. So much of what I am going to say is going to be based on our interviews with the prisoners, their families, and lawyers. Out of these 250, a little over 250, I have personally interviewed about 125 prisoners. And I'm happy to answer any questions as we go along. given that this event is being organized in terms of understanding what a campaign should look like, my first submission would be that we really need to stop focusing, at least we need to redirect some of the focus beyond the Supreme Court as far as the death penalty is concerned. This problem of numbers that everybody seems to be concerned with, that, you know, what are we talking about when there are only about three executions in a decade, and that somehow seems to take away from the intensity of the campaign. And it is my argument that problem arises because we're looking only at one end of the spectrum when the case has gone through all the stages and the mercy petition has been rejected, and that's where the focus is, and that's a large part of the problem with death penalty, anti-death penalty campaign in this country, in whatever form it might exist. I think there's a need to radically shift attention to the other end of the spectrum, which is at the trial court stage, which is, and to see what our trial courts are doing, what is our investigation processes, what is wrong in investigation processes in death penalty cases, what is wrong in the kind of evidence that is being used by trial courts, what is wrong with the sentencing procedure that trial courts are adopting. And unless we shift that attention, we will never be able to capture as to what is truly wrong with the death penalty. What is wrong with the death penalty? It's a sort of limited legal and a limited legal imagination to think that the only thing that's wrong with the death penalty is the fact of death. I mean, that is not the way to imagine. There's a lot of suffering before the person actually gets there. And that is somehow unique to death penalty. And much of what we've been seeing bears testament to that it's not as much the fact of dying that actually tortures these prisoners. It's a lot of other factors surrounding it that causes the problem. In terms of, and I think a large part of it, and I've been thinking about why there's been so little focus on anything but Supreme Court judgments, or how mercy is being rejected. And I think a large part of it is that as part of our legal discourse, we've accepted this argument that judicial delay is somehow, is irrelevant in understanding the suffering of death penalty. While yes, it might be that accepting that argument that judicial delay is irrelevant might be necessary for legal strategy, litigation strategy, but as for advocacy, we cannot accept that norm that judicial delay is irrelevant. And a lot, and for a person on death row, it's not like he or she is very is in a calm state of mind because he or she has only been sentenced to death by the trial court, and yet there are years and years lying ahead of that person to go through the High Court and the Supreme Court and the mercy. That's certainly not the case, right? And somehow very little work gets done, or very little attention gets paid to that end of suffering of these prisoners. In terms of, and I want to just address a few things that we've been seeing, and I think there is a need to address, as one of the speakers said, the concerns, and I think it was Professor Patnaik, who said that there's a need to address this idea, the arguments from the other side. And one of the arguments that he said was of deterrence. And one of the questions we ask the prisoners is, and that, A, first thing you need to recognize is a large proportion of them are first-time offenders. Nearly 98% of them are first-time offenders. This whole construct that you have in mainstream discourse, that these are hardened criminals, waiting to commit crime as soon as you release them, that seriously needs to be questioned with empirical evidence. And there's a lot of intuitive positions that we take in the anti-death penalty campaign in India backed by very little evidence. And that the aim of the project is to supply that evidence to those stands that we are taking. On the question of deterrence, one of the questions that we do ask is, what the prisoners themselves think of the death penalty, and whether what they were thinking, or at least tried and get them to recollect after so many years, of whether at all the law was even a consideration in their mind when those crimes were committed, or, you know, at least to those people who admit to us that they did commit the crime that that they're being convicted of. That was it even a consideration that what the law would, whether the law would take its own course? And for many of them, the argument is that those crimes were committed in such times of mental distress that the law never really enters this balancing of, it's not like this cold logical calculation of, you know, am I going to get arrested if I do this? Am I going to get, are they going to hang me if I do this? That, and I think a lot of us, while talking of deterrence, view it within that architecture, that there is this cold logic operating, right? What are the chances that I will get caught by the police or prosecuted in this entire discussion? And that, clearly that argument fails when you talk to death row prisoners. Second, is the stigma, right? Stigma operates at two levels. Death row prisoners are subject, when they're first brought to the jails, to significant, especially in the cases of when they're brought into jails for sexual violence, a lot of violence from prisoners themselves, from other prisoners in jail, a lot of violence across, and again, what I'm saying operates a lot, there's a lot of regional variation in how these things operate. Like in the interviews in Kerala, irrespective of whether it was sexual violence or not, prisoners seem to have been subject to a lot of violence. But this pattern that prisoners who are brought in for sexual violence into the jails seems to be operating across the board on the fact that other prisoners, or at least the prisoners themselves, believe that the jail staff that get the other prisoners to, you know, inflict violence upon them. The other is, very often we forget the impact of families of prisoners sentenced to death. And one of the interviews that comes to mind is of this prisoner's mother we interviewed in Bhagalpur district. The prisoner was sentenced to death by the trial court, yet to be confirmed by the High Court, was sentenced to death for the rape and murder of a three-year-old who was a neighbor. The body was found in his house, and then the trial was completed in about 3 months. And when we went to interview his mother, we were told that she begs for a living, so that we'll have to wait up until she comes back late at night. It was just a hutman. And when did she? And when we waited for her to come back, and the scene that unfolded was so hostile. The entire village gathered around. They were drunken men who entered the hut, were abusing her, were threatening to beat her, and wanted us to tell them why we were so interested in talking to the rapist's mother. And you have to think of this in the sort of dynamic wherever we go for these interviews, you know, it's immediately like, oh, people from Delhi have come to talk to us. So you can imagine when the mother of the accused is being threatened to such violence, I mean, even in our presence, one can only imagine what her everyday life would be in that village. And there's very little, and the evidence in these cases is another story altogether. Especially in Bihar, there is a very, very strong, what one might call the Nirbhaya effect to be seen. Rape cases by the trial courts are completed very, very quickly. The evidence is dismal, and it's amazing that our courts that our courts are allowed to sentence people to death on the kind of evidence that is being seen in these cases. And we don't even get to the stage of analyzing trial court judgments. We are still so stuck in looking at appellate court decisions, right, which by themselves pose a very significant problem. But to understand the true nature, the true problem with the death penalty in India, we really need to shift a lot of attention to other parts of the criminal justice system. And until we do that, we are going to confront this problem that, you know, what are you arguing about? Jail authorities ask us, what is the problem? You clearly, our system is working if about 80 or 85% of the cases are commuted by the High Court and then some more cases are commuted by the Supreme Court. Clearly the system is working. And I think there is a great need to address that argument that the system is not working. And the system is at its most rotten at the bottom. And that is why we give it least attention. In terms of socio-economic composition, our sort of findings so far, and again, this is very, very preliminary, it's not done in any sort of scientific way yet, because we're waiting to complete the interviews. Very poor, absolutely confirms that. Illiterate, importantly, anti-terror legislations, prisoners sentenced to death as a result of anti-terror legislations are largely Dalit or Muslim. Very, very few that fall outside that category, right? Dalit or Muslim, right? I think the cases in Bihar point to that. If you look at Lakshmanpur Bathe, the carnage, the Lakshmanpur Bathe carnage, the Bhumiyar accused, the cases that we instituted against them were under IPC. But if you look for the Bara massacre, the cases that were instituted against the Dalits are under Tada, right? I think Lakshmanpur Bathe also, cases like Lakshmanpur Bathe raise significant challenges for the anti-death penalty campaign. A lot of what was coming out after the Patna High Court acquitted all the accused in the Lakshmanpur Bathe cases, of all the accused in the Lakshmanpur Bathe massacre, I got the sense that a lot of people were not happy about the fact that they were acquitted. But the point I want to make, and if you may just bear with me as to what I'm saying, if you analyze the evidence in the Lakshmanpur Bathe case and the Bara massacre, they're largely of the similar nature, right? You know, nobody has really seen them commit the act. The only evidence that is there is that they were part of a crowd, and then the judges have assumed that they've done it and given the death sentence. And my point is simply this, that evidence is not good enough to sentence anybody to death. Be it in Lakshmanpur Bathe or in the Bara massacre, it is just not good enough. And what was missing in the discourse post Lakshmanpur Bathe, the acquittal from the Patna High Court, the response cannot be that, how do you let them go, right? The question should have been, why wasn't the same stand taken in the Bara massacre case, right? Where the nature of the evidence is very, very, it's very similar. And it can't be that when cases like Lakshmanpur Bathe come, there's some sort of tacit message that's being sent out that, you know what, we were sort of disappointed in this, right? Maybe the Patna High Court should have taken a more stringent stand, but the evidence was just not good enough. Then the focus must be on why the police had such lousy evidence before the courts. In terms of prison conditions, and again, this goes back to the suffering of the prisoners, only a minuscule number of jails allow death row prisoners to work. Almost across the country, death row prisoners are not allowed to work. A lot of them want to work, because all that happens then is that they are left, but it's not like they're allowed to do anything else. Jail authorities, when they ask, when prisoners ask for work, respond with, anyway, you're going to die, why do you want to work? Or why do you want to study? Right? Why do you want to get, why do you want to acquire new skills? So this entire idea that there's some sort of reformation happening, and I'm talking of death, prisoners sentenced to death only by the trial court. I'm not talking of only cases where their mercy has been rejected and they're awaiting execution. Right from the stage at which they're sentenced to death by the trial court, and yet there's a long legal process to be completed, prisoners are not allowed to work. And these are battles for the anti-death penalty campaign to identify within this larger abolitionist agenda, that there are smaller battles to be fought before you launch a full frontal attack on the death penalty itself. One thing I want to counter in this entire narrative is placing this blame on legal aid lawyers. And I think we sorely underestimate the problem as far as the quality of legal representation is concerned. It is not that only legal aid lawyers are the ones that are providing lousy legal representation, right? A lot of these people are extremely poor. Their families are, yes, if you talk to them, they're actually scared of government lawyers, legal aid lawyers. So what they do is that they sell all that they have in the attempt to hire a private lawyer. And they do hire private lawyers, paying them about 250 rupees per appearance or whatever. And the kind of representation that private lawyers hand out to death row prisoners is just as problematic. There is and what we're seeing is a large number of them. Nobody ever goes and talks to prisoners. Nobody has bothered to find out what their narrative is on these events. I'm not saying what they're saying is true or false. I'm not making any claim to that, and I cannot make any claim to that. But the first time, and you will see the difference in narrative from what they say happened and what the trial court has recorded. Because a lawyer, be it legal aid or private lawyers, very, very few of them actually bother to sit with the prisoner and find out what is happening. Let alone tell the prisoner as to what evidence is coming against them, or what their response to the evidence might be. And I think that alienation from the legal process is extreme. And it is extreme not just at the trial court stage, it is also prevalent to a very high degree in the appellate court stages, because prisoners have no clue of when the hearings are, when their cases are being heard, what the progress in their cases are. So the only thing prisoners are left to worry about is when they're going to be hanged. Or one fine day the news will come that their sentence has been commuted, because nobody in the system bothers to tell them as to what is happening with their cases, right? And I think unless we start grappling with these micro issues and not just give our complete attention to why rarest of the rare is inconsistent, or and hoping that someday the Supreme Court will see the light of that and strike down the death penalty, unless we build a case from the bottom, our fight is not going to be a strong one against the death penalty. And I think one thing we also ask prisoners as to what is the difference that they feel when they especially the cases post mercy, as to what was there any difference between waiting for their death, the judicial confirmation, as opposed to waiting for their decision on their mercy petition. And yes, and it's instructive to understand, and we all say it is torture, but what actually constitutes a torture? Why is it torture for a person to wait for their mercy petition decision? And one response that I got sort of pretty much captured it for me, that the cruelty of it is that when you're waiting for your mercy petition, any sound you hear, right? It might be these huge padlocks that are there on these jail doors and these gates. Any sound that they hear at night, they're not able to sleep because they think they're coming to get them. They're waiting to hear any sound. And in many prisons, they're kept very close to the gallows. So if they hear somebody sweeping the gallows or the gates of the gallows being opened, they think it is for them. And this constant engagement with their own death, right, that it is time, that any day could be the last day, that is really the torture for them, right? And I think going ahead, I really think that any sort of campaign should think about, given the criminal justice system that we operate in, it has to have a preventive element. We can't wait to work only with those cases once the death penalty has been awarded by the trial court. It has to have a certain preventive element where people just don't get sentenced to death. And that has to be an area of focus, including concentrating on sentencing in trial courts. Abysmal record, what we are hearing from the prisoners is it's a complete sham as far as sentence of what happens in the sentencing stage. That the only thing that the lawyers will say is that, he's poor, he has a family, that's it, right? And there is no nuanced engagement with sentencing happening in the trial courts. So in conclusion, I think I would only say that there needs to be a radical rethink on the manner in which the anti-death penalty campaign is being structured, and we really need to focus on the other end of the spectrum as well. Thank you.